people with the rod of lock of the heritage, holding solitude in the wood, in the midst of Carmel, who dwell in the midst of Carmel, who dwell in the midst of Carmel.
The caption for this morning message is My Time. Last week, seven sins of time. That was the caption. The theme continues, My Time. Psalm 35 verse 28, and my tongue shall speak of thy righteousness and of thy praise all the day long. My tongue shall speak of thy righteousness and of thy praise all the day long. The phrase my tongue appears in the Bible 20 times. Out of those 20 times, Job, the book of Job 5 times, and the book of Psalms 11 times, Job and Psalms 16 times, that phrase, my time. See, God doesn't like a lying tongue. God doesn't like a flattering tongue, a proud tongue, a backbiting tongue, etc., etc. But what about my time? So again this week I want to confine our meditation only with the book of Psalms. So what was the experience of the psalmist even in the Old Testament about his tongue? He was an Old Testament saint. He had a lot of failures in his life. But in this Old Testament saint was able to make a confession about his own tongue. It's my tongue. So I'm just taking into account the tongue of the psalmist, a great prophet. I mean, among all the Old Testament prophets, the messianic prophecy about David was great in number. Even Isaiah comes after that. And very specially, the crucifixion was very vividly brought out by David than anybody else. On the cross, Jesus quoted one of the Psalms of David, Psalm 22. He quoted one of the Psalms of David. So we'll just consider the tongue of David and we can feel that we must be able to guard our tongue in such a way. So my tongue. In Psalm 35 verse 28, the opening text what we read, and my tongue shall speak of thy righteousness. So he has got that great confidence about his tongue. My tongue shall speak of thy righteousness. In Psalm 51 verse 14, deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God, thou God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness.
My tongue shall speak of thy righteousness. My tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. 71:24. Again he says, my tongue also shall talk of thy righteousness all the day long. My tongue shall speak of thy righteousness. My tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness. My tongue shall talk of thy righteousness all day long. So what do we mean by righteousness? Philosophically, the word righteousness means right standing with God. Right standing with God, that's righteousness. So I have given this example many a time, but that's a very fitting example to understand what righteousness means. Righteousness has nothing to do with a moral standard. A moral standard may be included in it, but a moral standard itself is not righteousness. What is right for God is right for me. See, when Abraham was 75 years old, and God called Abraham to Canaan, God promised that I'll give you a child through Sarah. That is, I'll give you a seed, a generation. So he came, 10 years passed by. When he was 85, the Lord told him that I would give you a child. But Sarah was barren. So Abraham said, Lord, let this Eliezer be my successor. I'm imagining to have children and all doesn't work out. Let Eliezer be my successor. Days passed by. Hagar came into the scene. So when he was 85 plus and Sarah was 75 plus, when all hopes are lost, Sarah gave a suggestion. No, don't depend on this Eliezer and all. It's better we'll have a child through your child, maybe through Hagar. In those days, the slaves are a property to the owners. So Hagar was almost a property, a possession to Sarah. The child born to the slave is also her own possession. A slave cannot have any right on the child. So this is the culture or practice in those days. So Ishmael was born. 12 years passed by. Now Abraham was 99 years old. God told Abraham, I'll give you a child through Sarah. Abraham laughed. Many times preachers say, Sarah laughed. The Bible says, Abraham laughed. Abraham didn't believe it. It's not that Abraham was a believer in this matter all through. At 75 he believed. 85 little dawns. Then he lost all belief. Ishmael. When he was 99, there's no belief. He said, Lord, don't be kidding. It's enough. Let Ishmael live before you. Bless this little boy Ishmael born out of that slave woman. Let Ishmael live. That was the stand of Abraham. So Abraham's stand, let Ishmael live. God's stand, I'll give you a child through Sarah. See, two different stands. Abraham could not believe what God says. This is God's stand. I'll give a child to Sarah. This is Abraham's belief. Let Ishmael live. We don't know what happened. Suddenly, Abraham started believing against hope. Somehow Abraham started believing that he will have a child through Sarah. That is the belief. His body is dead. He lost his potency. Sarah is already barren. Now her period stopped. No hope. Against hope, he hoped. Yes, I'll have a child through Sarah. He believed. Till yesterday he didn't believe. Till yesterday he thought, let Ishmael live. Now suddenly believe. No, I will have a child through Sarah. I will have a child through Sarah. He started believing. So his stand became the stand of God. When his stand became the stand of God, it is counted unto his righteousness. It is counted unto his righteousness. What is righteousness? God's stand is your stand. Committing totally to the will of God. Say for example, so I want to do ministry. It's good. But what is God's desire about me? What is God's plan about me? Everybody should do ministry. Should I resign my job and come to the full-time ministry, or I should work, yearn and do God's ministry? What is God's plan for me? Now I say, no, I should resign my job, I should come out, I should be fully dedicated for the Lord's ministry, I should not have any other civil work. Okay? Now when I want to do the Lord's ministry, I resign my job and come out, and what should I do? Should I be a missionary? Should I become an evangelist? Should I help a servant of God, a senior servant of God? As Elisha was helping Elijah, should I help a servant of God? Or should I pastor a church? What is my role? I come out, I resign my job. I resigned a job in a corporate company and I got a job in the church. That's not a full-time ministry. You were in the pay list of one company, now you are a pay list of another company, another organization. But what is that the Lord wants me to do? When the Lord wants me to be a missionary, I say, no, it's good that I'll be a pastor so that I can look after the education of my children and I have to look after my parents. So I better be a pastor here. I want to do the ministry. No, I don't want to be a pastor. I want to be a missionary. No. Righteousness is not doing the ministry. Righteousness is not resigning your job and coming to the ministry. Righteousness is not just doing a full-time ministry. Righteousness is what is right for God should be right for you. What is the stand God takes, I must take that stand. That is righteousness. He that is righteous can be righteous still. See, I became a pastor. Now I want to preach a message. It's not that I preach a message I want to preach. What is the message the Lord wants to preach? I take the same stand. I want to deal with the believers. Then I say, okay, oh, it's a newcomer, I should not talk like this. Oh, this is an old believer, I should talk like this. Oh, he is a very rich man, he is giving, contributing a lot of money to the ministry, I should not hurt him. No, I am not righteous. I am not righteous. What is the stand the Lord wants me to take, I should take. So he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. Now my tongue speaks righteousness. So what should my tongue speak? I should speak out what is right for God. When I know this is the truth, when I know this is what God wants me to say, I should not hesitate to say that. With love, affection, firmness, I must be able to speak out. He put words in my mouth, not only to build, but to pull down, to break. So I speak righteousness, it means I speak out what is right for God. What is right for God? God's principles. That's God's righteousness. What is right with God is right with me. My dear brother, my dear sister, this is very, very important. And number two that goes almost close with this, Psalm 37 verse 30. Psalm 37 verse 30. The mouth of the righteous speaketh wisdom, and his tongue, the tongue of the righteous speaketh judgment. Speaketh judgment. What is judgment? Not only righteousness. It is not the judgment that's given by a judge in the court. It is the judgment of the righteous. He is able to adjudge his situation correctly. He is able to judge what is right, what is wrong. He is able to discern between good and evil. So you are driving a car. When you are driving a car, you must be able to make the right judgment. As a good driver, you must know what is the speed in which that person is coming. Will I be able to cross the road or not? What is the gap before me? Will my vehicle go within that gap or not? He judges. He makes a wrong judgment. A car is coming from the cross. I think that I can go before he would come. I make a wrong judgment. I am unable to judge his speed properly, there will be an accident. He's coming from my right. I thought that I could cross him before he would come. I made a wrong judgment. My vehicle will get into an accident. There's a small gap. I thought my car would go in that gap. I checked this side, that side, right? Or a car would go in that gap. I made a wrong judgment. My vehicle will be damaged. My vehicle will be damaged. So we make judgments. Similarly in a spiritual life, we make a lot of judgments. There is a problem in your family. You make a judgment. Shall I say this to my wife or should not I say this? What is God's principle? I should take a stand of God. God says, you must tell your wife, I must tell my wife. I want to take a stand with God. Now I make a judgment. How to say that? Will that make a havoc? Judgment. I should make the right judgment. There are two or three children. I speak to them. For one child, a staring will be enough. Just a stare at the child, it's enough. For another child, a scolding may be necessary. With another child, a stern action may be necessary. So I judge. Where I have to take a stern action, just a look may not help. Where I can solve a problem with a look, I should not be going for spanking. So I must be able to judge. So here the word in the original, or what today's word, we can say justice. The word given judgment here, equity, justice, right, proper, rectitude, etc. The word equity is very powerful. Probably that word is very much used in the accountancy. So the other day I was explaining that word equity. There is a profit of 20,000 rupees. So I am giving equally to Jephtha and John. That is equal. 10,000 to Jephtha, 10,000 to John. Now, instead of going for equity, he has got 3 shares. He has got 2 shares. So those 20,000. Now, I'm not giving 10-10 each. I share it in that ratio. I give him 12,000 because he has got 3 shares. I give him 8,000 because he has got only 2 shares. That is equity. I haven't wronged anybody. 12,000 to Jephtha, that is his share. 8,000 to John, that is his share. They will not be fighting. I need not be equal always. A child has got a tooth extract, the mother may give ice cream. Another child may have cold, suffering from common cold, and it will also scream for ice cream. The mother will say, you scream, but I won't give ice cream. That mother is not partial. That's equity, that's justice. This child has got tooth extraction, we have to stop bleeding, so I'll give ice cream. The child is suffering from common cold, I should not give ice cream, that is justice. That is equity. So equity is not giving, justice is not giving, treating everybody equal. That's not justice. Justice is whatever punishment given to what type of a person. For somebody it is 8 years, somebody 5 years, somebody 2 years, somebody acquitted. Not giving the same punishment to all accused is not justice. So here justice is equity, and the philosophical meaning of that word is very, very powerful. Speaking right, please listen, speaking right as a consequence of being honorable or honest. That honesty is within. I want to be honorable. I am honorable. I am honest. Because I am honest, I speak the right thing or the proper thing. Basically, I want to be honest. Not only I want to be honest, honesty is within me. Because honesty is within me, I speak what is right. I speak what is proper. So my tongue, I speak justice. What is proper? What is right for this person? What is right for that person? So the second thing, I speak justice. In Proverbs 10:20, the tongue of the just, the tongue of one who speaks justice, the tongue of the just is a choice silver, very precious. The choice silver, very precious. He says the right thing to the right person. There is equity in his words, honesty in his heart. He's not partial. He's not saying different things to different people. People are different. So not only he has got God's righteousness, number two, he speaks the right thing in the right place, in a proper way. That's why he's a wise person. He weighs that situation. He weighs the word that he should use. It's very, very powerful. So the second thing, he speaks justice. The third one, Psalm 39 verses 3 and 4. Psalm 39 verse 3. My heart was hot within me, and while I was musing, the fire burned. Then spake I with my tongue, and said, O Lord, O Lord. Number three, my tongue takes my problems to God. I speaks what is right with God. I speak the right, proper thing. What is right I speak? Not only God's stand, what I speak is the right. This is what I must tell this child, this is how I must speak to this child. I speak the right thing. I do justice to both. The third one, I speak with God. Prayer is speaking with God. Of the prayer of Moses, the Bible says, as one who would speak with his friend, he was speaking with God. So prayer is speaking. Speaking with God is prayer. And about Daniel, he spoke and prayed. He spoke and prayed. It is talking with God, telling God your problems. Prayer is not reciting something. Prayer, biblically, is not a ritual. Prayer is sharing your burden with Jesus. I must tell Jesus all my burdens. What a friend we have in Jesus. What peace we often forfeit. Because we do not carry everything to the Lord in prayer. So about this I can go on and on and on and on. But we have listened to many messages on prayer. So but our tongue, is taking our problems to God. Many a time. We share our problem with our parents, with our mother, with our father. Sometimes we share it with our friends. Sometimes we may even share it with our colleagues, neighbors, relatives. So you speak to them. You tell them your problems. Sometimes they give some counsel, but many a time the remedy might be worse than the malady. Many a time you tell others your problems, and they will tell you back their problems. Probably one consolation you can get, okay, their problem is worse than my problem. So you can get a type of consolation. They may not be able to help. Sometimes you go and tell your problems with your relatives or somebody. And after listening to your problem, they will be broken. They won't be able to help you. They will be broken. There is a small story in philosophy. A mother was living with her son, daughter-in-law. But there were some problems she could not manage. She could not share her problem with anybody. She was very lonely. She just left the house in the night. She walked and walked and walked through that night. She didn't know where she was going. Out of that village, there was an old temple porch, mandapam, coil mandapam. It's already in the collapsing condition. Three pillars were almost damaged. The fourth pillar, the whole building was standing on that one pillar, that porch. She wanted to lie down there, but she was a little risky. But somehow she felt she should say her problem with somebody. She started talking with that pillar. She talked, all of a sudden that pillar started crumbling, the whole building was coming down. She just has breath, she escaped. The porch collapsed. So she asked the fourth pillar, what happened? Why suddenly it collapsed? Even this porch could not give a shade for me. I could not even sleep here in the night. That pillar said, like many people came, they all were sharing their problems with us, and one by one three pillars damaged. I alone was standing. You came and shared your problems, your burdens, all your burdens you left on me. I also broke. When you share your problems with somebody, they will also break. But speak with God. I don't say that you should not share your problems for prayer request. You can have prayer partners. Those who can understand and pray with you. I don't say that's absolutely wrong, you understand this message. But going and sharing a problem with a pillar is not going to help you. Some people will stand before the picture of a dead relative, a father, a mother, and they'll talk to that photo. Appa, parangappa. Many a time an evil spirit will take control of the situation because you're talking to a dead person. He won't be able to do anything. The rich man who died, he cannot come down and help his brothers. So talking to the dead people, they're not going to help you. In the Bible we don't understand even talking to saints, dead saints. They are resting. There's not a Bible reference that those saints could come and help us. Their spirits may be there, they are alive. Dead and alive, saints in Christ. But Peter, John and Anthony, Francis, nobody could come and help us. Mary, blessed among the women, she cannot come and help us. The Bible has got no reference. Many a time when we talk to some dead people, saints, or relatives, I don't have time to explain that. Some evil spirit will take control of that situation. We have to be very careful about it. So with your tongue, don't talk to a pillar. Don't talk to a person. You share your burden, not with a dead person, even a saint who lived and died. Speak with God. Speak with God. Speak with God. David doesn't say, I'll pray to Moses. David didn't say, I'll speak to Aaron. They all are saints, mightily used by God. They were standing before God. Abraham seen God face to face. Let me talk to Abraham my problems. Abraham is my father. I'll go to his sepulchre and I talk. No. My tongue will speak with God. When I muse, my soul is hot, burns within me. I open my mouth and I speak to God. Oh Lord, how long? My dear brother, my dear sister, for your blessing, for a divine deliverance, with your mouth, with your tongue, speak to God. Speak with God. That will give you tremendous deliverance. So number one, with your tongue, speak righteousness. What is right for God? That's the stand you should take. With your tongue, speak justice, equity, proper. Because there is honesty within you. Because of the consequence of the honesty, you are speaking the proper thing. There's no guile found in you. Number three, speak to God with your tongue. Don't share your problem. Maybe sharing with prayer, for prayer request. You are getting a prayer support. Absolutely it's not. Paul says, pray for us. So when Paul needs the prayer of the congregation, how much you and I need the prayer of others? Apart from that, just to get their sympathy, just for their hearing, believe that they could do something, don't take your prayers to anybody else. Psalm 45 verse 1. Psalm 45 verse 1. My heart is inditing a good manner. I speak of things which I have made touching the king. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. I have made touching things of the king. I speak of the king. He is the king of kings. I speak of God. I speak of God's attributes. how great He is, how loving He is, how much He sacrificed His life for us. My dear brother, my dear sister, your friends, your relatives, people of the world, they may worship different gods. They may worship different gods. It is their faith. It is not to criticize their gods, but is there any god like unto your God? Like unto your God. It is good that you also be knowing about those gods. They are spiritual gods, are mythological figures, are just in their pranas, their faith. It's better to know about them, about their lifestyle. Knowing is not wrong. It's better you could encourage them also to know about their gods. This is what they have done. This is what they have done. My dear brother, my dear sister, whom do we worship? We'll be like that person. Whom do we worship? We'll be like that person. You worship this God, you'll be like that God. You worship a God who doubted his own wife, you will doubt your own wife. It's very simple. You worship a God who robbed somebody else's wife. You worship a God who robbed somebody else's wife, and you will be like that God. It won't be wrong for that person. You worship this God, this holy God, you'll try to be holy, you will be holy. You think about your God, the Yahweh God, the embodiment of love. Think about His life. Think about His teachings. What is that He taught? What is His teachings? I'm not talking the life of Abraham, I'm not talking the life of Isaac. They were coming from Babylon. Abraham was coming from Babylon. Rebekah was coming from Paddan Aram. That culture, that Babylonian gods, that spirit was upon them. But think about the God. What was His teaching? What did He speak through Moses? What is that He has written in the hearts of the people all over the world? Think about that God, a holy God, a God who tells His people, be honest, don't be treacherous to your husband, don't be treacherous to your wife. God is your witness. This God says, God is your witness, holy God. As I am holy, you be holy. As I am holy, you be holy. Think about this God. Study about this God. It is not only you speak righteousness, you speak about this great God. God whom you worship. And that God, we believe, was revealed in Jesus. We see the teachings of Jesus. People may not like Jesus, may not love Jesus, but nobody can hate the teachings of Jesus. Can anybody say, no, no, we don't like the teachings of Jesus? They may say, we could not practice his teachings. So with your tongue, you speak about this Jesus, his saving power, his love, his mercies. Speak about God. Speak about his greatness. Speak about his holiness. Speak about his might, his counsel, his life, his expectations. Speak about this great God. My dear brother, my dear sister. And number five, when you speak about God, 119, 172, my tongue shall speak of thy word, for all thy commandments are righteousness. Number five, speak God's word. There is power in God's word. When I say speak God's word, speak God's commandments. The Bible says, God says, honor your parents. Tell your friends, they're worshipping other gods. You tell them what your God says. Tell them what your God says. My Jesus says, love your wife as you love yourself. My Jesus says. My Jesus says, obey your husband. My Bible says, honor your parents. Speak about the teachings of the Bible. Very honestly, I can tell you, to the best of my knowledge, with no disputation, there are good teachings in many books. In Tirukkural there are many good teachings. But no one book is parallel to the teachings of the Bible as they are revealed by Jesus Christ. We may misunderstand some of the Old Testament passages and the practices of saints, but the pure teachings of Jesus. You go and tell them this. And the prophecies, how those prophecies are fulfilled. How the prophecies of the Lord are fulfilled. How Israel is born again. How the European Union is formed. What is happening today? Does the Bible talk about this water scarcity? Does the Bible talk about the failure of democracy? So let our tongue, instead of speaking vain words, instead of speaking flattery, instead of speaking backbiting, instead of speaking lies, instead of speaking proud things, let my tongue speak God's words, God's commandments. Because God's word is God's mind in the written form. God's words are God's mind in the written form. So speak righteousness, God's righteousness. Then speak justice because honesty is within you. Speak to God. Speak about God. Speak God's word. In 2 Samuel chapter 23 verse 2. The Spirit of the Lord spake by me, and his word was in my tongue. I speak God's word because His word is in my tongue. Proverbs 12:18. There is that speaketh like the piercing of a sword, but the tongue of the wise is health. When you speak the word of God, it is a health to others. God willing, I'll speak on that later. I'll go to 6:1. Number 6. 66, Psalm 66, verse 1. I cried unto Him with my mouth, and He was extolled with my tongue. Again, I focus my attention to that phrase, my tongue. I extolled. Pugalrit. Speaking high. Praising God. It's not blaming God. It is not cursing God. It's always praising God. With my tongue, I praise God. I extol God. The more you speak the greatness of God, the more you praise, the power of God is released. There is power in the tongue. I'll speak about that later some other time. There is power in your tongue. The more you praise God, the prison doors will be open. The more you praise God, the glory of the Lord will descend. The more you praise, God dwells in the midst of the praises. The more you praise God, the power of God will be released. What you believe in your heart is unto righteousness. But when you give words to it, it is for your deliverance. So I will praise God. Psalm 35 verse 28, in our opening verse we read, and my tongue shall speak of the righteousness, of thy righteousness, and of thy praise all the day long. Whatever the situation may be, God is good. Andavare nir nallavarappa. Umalahadu undamillappa. Stotra andavare. Everything is in your control, O Lord. You are great, O Lord. You be praising God all the day. The Lord will take control of that situation. Mighty miracles will take place. And number 7, Psalm 126 verse 2. Then was our mouth filled with laughter. Our mouth, I take it for my mouth, it includes his mouth. Then was my mouth filled with laughter and my tongue with singing. When God gives His deliverance, when God does great things for us, when we speak the righteousness of God, when we speak His words, when we speak about His words, when we praise God, when God does great things for us, we started singing unto the Lord, shouting, praising God aloud. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord hath done great things for them. Then others shall see, oh, their God has done great things for them. In the tent of the righteous, there will be victory chant. Jaya Gambhira Satta Undar. So with your tongue, sing aloud. Praise God loudly. Rejoice, laugh. Because of the deliverance the Lord is giving. Because what God can do for you. The more you sing aloud, the more you praise God, the more you are happy, the more you get health. That is why we read in Psalm 15, Proverbs 15:4, a wholesome tongue is a tree of life. The healing tongue. The more you praise, the more you worship, the more you rejoice. If there is laughter in your tongue, glad tidings, singing in your tongue. That's a tree of life for your whole health. A wholesome tongue. What is a wholesome tongue? A praising tongue, a praying tongue, a tongue that speaks about God, a tongue that speaks the word of God, a wholesome tongue. A wholesome tongue, that's tree of life for you. That's health for you. Finally, I say one word and conclude. It's in Proverbs 21, verse 23. Whoso keepeth his tongue, keepeth his mouth and his tongue, keepeth his soul from troubles. If you know how to control your tongue, better way, if you know to handle your tongue, you keep your soul from trouble. If you don't know how to control your tongue, your soul will be in trouble. Your psyche will be in trouble. Your personality will be in trouble. If you know how to control your tongue, your soul will not have trouble. Your soul will be free from trouble. So seven sins, what we should not do, we consider. And how to keep my tongue? Seven things I have said. Use your tongue to speak what is right with God. Use your tongue to speak justice. Use your tongue to speak to God. Use your tongue to speak about God. Use your tongue to speak the word of God. Use your tongue to praise God. Use your tongue to love, to rejoice in the Lord. Not a merry myth of the world. Rejoice in the Lord. That is health for you. The conclusion about these two messages, if you know to handle your tongue, if you know to handle your tongue, your soul will be free from trouble. If you don't know to handle your tongue, your soul will be in trouble. Shall we pray?